Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the call to discuss the results of the PacifiCorp Integration Benefits Study. My name is Christina Osborne. I'm with the Stakeholder Process Group here at the ISO, and I'll be moderating the call. Also joining me in the room are representatives from ISO, PacifiCorp, and E3, and at in a few minutes, I'll ask them to introduce themselves. We will be taking questions after specific sections of the presentation. We have a high-level overview that we'll discuss, and then we'll talk about quantified benefits. We'll talk about costs, and then the procedure. So at those breaks, we'll take questions. You can enter the queue by either raising your hand through the web service, or you can also press star 1 on your telephone keypad. Just a reminder to please state your name and the company you represent before asking your question. We do want to make you aware that this call is being recorded, and that's so that folks who aren't able to participate, it allows them you know, opportunity to listen to the call. And that will be available on the ISO website, linked on the Regional Energy Markets page. It'll be available up until October 30th. So as soon as we get that link from AT&T, we'll post it. The study and other materials related to this effort are available on both the ISO and the PacifiCorp website. There are also links provided in this presentation to access this material. So at this time, I'll go ahead and have the folks in the room introduce themselves and then turn it over to Phil Pettengill, our facilitator.
Well, let me start. This is Phil Pettengill. As Christina was saying, she and I are going to work together in terms of facilitating the meeting today. I'm going to basically sort of be your moderator in terms of walking through the technical details, and Christina is going to help us with queuing up your questions and working through the webcast. I'm joined by a number of folks, and so let's go around the table real quick. First, we've got Jack Moore from E3. You want to introduce yourself, Jack?
Sure. Good morning. Jack Moore, from Director of Transmission Analysis from E3.
And we've got Rick Link from PacifiCorp.
Thanks, Phil. Rick Link, and I'm Director of Origination PacifiCorp, and that includes responsibilities for the company's integrated resource plan.
Carolyn Barbash from PacifiCorp.
Carolyn Barbash, yes. I am the executive sponsor for the Regional Integration Project for PacifiCorp.
And we've got Mark Rothleder.
Hi, Mark Rothleder, Vice President of Market Quality and Renewable Integration, and I was a technical lead in the from the ISO from the study report.
Great, thank you. And again, I mentioned I'm Phil Pettengill. I'm the Director for Regional Integration here at the ISO. And what I wanted to do is just sort of get everybody a little oriented in terms of what we were going to do for you this morning. First of all, we're just going to go through the report that's out there. We've got a slide deck to do that. And what we're going to do is break that deck into two pieces of information. First, very high-level summary. We want to go through the results, get everybody oriented in terms of what we found in this joint study that we've done, and then we'll move into a second phase, which is to dive a little bit deeper dive into the details about how those results were discovered. So we'd like to go through each one of the sections first, take the speakers and go through them, and then we'll stop and take your questions in the three different points that Christina. We certainly want to make sure you understand what's in the report, and I think we're going to make sure we've got plenty of time in order to answer your questions. So with that, I think we're ready to dive in, and Jack, I'm going to let you get us started.
Great. Thanks, Billy. Good morning, everyone. So I think we covered the overall agenda here today. Just for orientation, for the first three sections, which is the high-level overview, we've got about 10 slides. To both introduce and talk about next steps. Then, after the first round of questions, we'll get into that detailed analysis and wrap up with a cost discussion as well, and finish up with questions and answers. For the next slide, as we mentioned earlier, the report and the technical appendix are available on these websites. At the links in this presentation. If you have it available, you might want to just have it handy in case different questions have issues that we can refer to, but otherwise you can also look at it later as well. So, is that it? Rick?
I think Mark. So Mark, why don't you start on this slide?
So the just to introduce you to the California ISO a little bit, the ISO's footprint, it has about 65,000 megawatts of supply capacity. Our peak demand is about 50,000 megawatts, and that was back in 2006. We have not peaked since then. This year's peak is in about 47,000 plus range. We have 26,000 circuit miles of transmission, serving about 30 million customers in California, covering about 80% of the California demand and customers. Currently, our market operates probably and clears about 28,000 transactions per day in the market. And obviously, the ISO, where it's situated, has transfer capability both from the north and the south. Our total transfer capability is about 13,000 megawatts import capability into the ISO.
Rick?
Thanks, Mark. Similar metrics, I'll just kind of walk through these for PacifiCorp. On PacifiCorp system, I'll start by just noting that today we're operating two balancing authority areas. I'm kind of referring to them often in the east and the west side of our system. Across both of those balancing authority areas, PacifiCorp has a little over 11,000 megawatts of own generating plant capacity. Our record peak was reached actually just this year to over 12,600 megawatts on June 29th of 2015. We cover a pretty broad, expansive geographic region, and with that, we've got over 16,000 circuit miles of transmission lines, 1.8 million customers. Those customers are in six different states across the West. I'll note that the own generation includes another three states, so we have six states with load and an additional three states with generation capacity on top of that, and about 70 million megawatt hours of electricity delivered annually. And it might just be worth noting, looking at this map and differentiating how a full integration would differ from an EIM, that today with PacifiCorp's participation in the EIM, there is connectivity with the ISO primarily through the, or on the west side of our system, through the Pacific Power as indicated on the map, whereas a full integration would provide opportunities for connectivity through both the east and west side of PacifiCorp's system as that interfaces the ISO.
Thank you, Rick. Hey, Jack, before we jump into the next slide, one thing I wanted to do for definition for everybody is to recognize, sort of tailing on what Rick was just saying, this study looked at an integration to bring all these pieces together into a single balancing authority. So as we walk through these numbers and you start to understand what's in the study, we'll be describing what the results are as a single balancing authority. And then it's also important to recognize that all these numbers are incremental to EIM. These are additional benefits on top of the benefits that are already accruing to California and to PacifiCorp as part of the EIM market that's been running for now. So, Jack?
Great. So, on slide five, at the highest level, the study sought to estimate the reasonable range of high and low savings from integration, both for PacifiCorp and for the ISO. So we represent these savings here as a 20-year present value of benefit starting in the year 2020 and going to 2039. And as you can see in the table, together in the low range for PacifiCorp and ISO together, this would be about $3.4 billion in savings on low end over that period. And about $9.1 billion on the high end of that savings. So making up those benefits, the study quantified four major categories of savings, and that's one of the major focuses of our presentation today. So these four major categories break down here. So the first being more efficient unit commitment and dispatch. That would be improvement in efficiency of generation, dispatch, finding opportunities to avoid running plants at inefficient levels or having to start and stop units frequently to adjust to changes in load. The second is lower peak capacity savings. So that is savings that results from a diversity of the peaks, or the times when each system needs power to serve its system peak, and as a result, can avoid a bit of capacity that's needed to be procured to meet the combined systems requirements. The third category of benefits is more efficient overgeneration management, and this is a benefit that results from day-ahead coordination that allows the system to more flexibly respond to the possibility of overgeneration, particularly on the California side, and use more efficient and scheduling to be able to export that energy that would have been potentially needed to be curtailed, and also create efficiency by reducing the dispatch of thermal units. Lastly, the final category of benefits is renewable procurement savings, and this is savings from a integrated transmission planning, which could facilitate more efficient and lower cost procurement for of renewable resources for a longer time period. So slide six summarizes the scenarios needed to create this high and low range. So overall, we focused our analysis for this 20-year period on two project test years, approximately 5- and 10-year outlook after integration would occur, which gave us a 2024 and 2030 focus year. These years are also important for two other reasons. First, as discussed in the most recent IRP, there are a number of transitions that are happening on their system with resource changes over this period. So we wanted to show how benefits and changes occur in that range. And secondly, California has just recently adopted a 50% RPS for 2030, which will trigger the need for new renewable energy procurement over the time period. The interim target would be 40% by 2024. And so this shows and captures the impact on integration savings from a transition over this growing amount of renewable procurement needed. In terms of the scenarios developed, there's a few major differences between the low and high cases that we have. Overall, the low range of savings, first of all, takes a low range of surveyed dispatch and unit commitment benefits that we observed as a percentage across a number of other studies, and uses that value to calculate integration savings for unit commitment dispatch benefits. Secondly, the low range savings uses PacifiCorp's preferred scenario in its IRP to identify the need date for new capacity additions, which would be starting in the year 2028. And this impacts the peak capacity savings and the opportunity for peak capacity savings in the scenarios we developed. Third, on overgeneration management, the limited overgeneration management to a transmission capability of 776. Megawatts, meaning the connection between the ISO and PacifiCorp, and we can get into more detail about that later in this presentation. And last of all, on renewable procurement savings, we excluded potential benefits from that category that could be enabled by joint transmission planning. The high range scenario, by contrast, uses the upper end of the surveyed studies on potential improvements in dispatch and unit commitment efficiency. It took an accelerated scenario for capacity needs for the PacifiCorp system for calculating out peak capacity savings by assuming that the first need actually would occur in 2024. It has the same limit, actually, as the low scenario for generation management of that 776 megawatts. But there's a difference across the two time periods as a result of across the two time periods in terms of over generation management as a result of the rising amount of RPS over the time period evaluated. And finally, the high scenario also includes this renewable procurement savings that's enabled by joint transmission planning that allows for the development of Wyoming wind at a lower cost than the base case. So going to the results of that, slide 7 summarizes the annual cost savings on the left for the core, on the right for the ISO, and it shows this both for each of the two study years and for the low and high scenarios. The different colors break out the different categories of benefit. So the thing is here, the green bars represent the renewable procurement savings that happen in the high case. The orange bars represent more efficient overgeneration management. The light blue color is savings related to lower peak capacity needs. And the dark blue savings represents the benefits from more efficient unit commitment dispatch. So for example, if we take the far left bar here, under the low scenario for 2024 for PacifiCorp, we show in the study $31 million of more efficient unit commitment and dispatch savings, as well as, it turns out, $31 million savings for more efficient overgeneration management. Going just as another example on the far right bar, the high case scenario for the ISO for 2030, there's $65 million in that year of lower peak capacity needs, $138 million of savings from overgeneration management, and $691 million from renewable procurement savings, which is the biggest single category overall. Looking broadly at this, overall, I think at a high level, Pacific savings largely come from operational cost savings, both from fuel and energy procurement costs from participation in the day-ahead market, as well as some additional savings from importing renewable energy when California has excess supply and peak capacity as a result of load diversity. And there's also, in the high case, some of the renewable benefits for support as well. The ISO savings are largely from investment cost savings. They're both the biggest one from procuring lower cost energy in the high scenario. Secondly, savings from reducing the need to replace overgeneration with additional renewables to meet energy policy goals. And third, peak capacity savings as a result of that same load diversity. I think.
Thanks, Jack. I just comment on some of these findings that Jack just walked us through at a summary level. To note that, as both PacifiCorp and ISO have reviewed these results and really tried to interpret what these benefits might mean, that we have found that these quantified benefits are sufficient to support continued progress toward PacifiCorp and ISO integration. So at this stage, these results indicate that we should continue to move forward and continue to study and evaluate this integration effort. And to note that even in the low scenario, there can be some significant benefits for both PacifiCorp and the ISO. It's also worth noting that, I'd say over time, that integration would provide both PacifiCorp and ISO greater flexibility to respond to ongoing changes in both state and federal environmental policies to develop renewable energy resources across the region and to reduce greenhouse gas emissions at a lower cost. And so, Mark, I don't know if you've got anything to add about our takeaways.
Yeah, I think from the ISO perspective, we also view the quantified benefits as really sufficient enough to continue to also make progress towards the integration. I do want to, in the next slide, I want to point out that while the report does quantify some very significant benefits, The report also discusses several benefits that are not quantified. In particular, the report does discuss things like impacts on greenhouse gas, and there is particular interest in understanding the impacts of greenhouse gas, impacts of the integration. I think the conclusions of the, with regards to the greenhouse gas, the short-term conclusion is that there is at least opportunity for some displacement of emitting resources producing greenhouse gas with the more efficient dispatch, the opportunity for better management of overgeneration. And in the longer term, there is the opportunity for more efficient ways of meeting things like clean power plan and supporting the clean power plan that may generate even greater greenhouse benefits in the longer term. Realizing that this report does not quantify those greenhouse gas benefits, I do want to point out that the ISO will be undertaking work in support of SB 350, California State Bill SB 350, where we will be exploring the greenhouse gas impacts of a regional market. And there will be opportunity for further quantification beyond what is discussed in this paper. The other thing I want to point out is we do have some experience from the energy imbalance market, and although not in the report, I do want to point out that we have at least data now that we're publishing in our monthly performance reports that indicates what is supporting the transfers into California. And what we do see, if you take beyond November and December of last year, when we were, which at that time we were dealing with some transitional issues, we were seeing is basically very low quantities of coal dispatch that are supporting transfers into California. Effectively, less than 0.5% of the transfers are being supported by coal dispatch outside of California in the EIM transfers. Most of the transfers are being supported either by gas redispatch or non-emitting resources such as hydro resources. And so that information we will continue to publish on a monthly basis as part of our normal monthly performance reports, but I think it's a good indicator of the experience at least we're having with regards to coal dispatch and greenhouse gases under the EIM dispatch. Other non-quantified benefits that are discussed in the paper include other things that we believe that will lead to lower costs, although they're not quantified. For example, the coordinated transmission plan, although there are some specific benefits that are quantified relative to the procurement of new renewable resources, we do expect that the coordinated transmission plan more generally will garner additional benefits in terms of getting to the right mix of transmission to support efficiencies across the integrated balancing area. In addition, there are other things like compliance with things like frequency response and other operating reserves that, although not quantified, we do expect that there could be benefits of meeting those frequency response and other requirements in an integrated way. The other thing is that just the general market solutions and increased liquidity, we believe, will also gain benefits both for PacifiCorp and the ISO. And it should be noted that while the benefits do not quantify specific benefits for the ISO for the more efficient dispatch because they already have a day-ahead market, we do believe that the increased liquidity will result in additional benefits again for ISO out of that integrated dispatch. Another area is with regards to reliability, and in the reliability area, we believe that the increased diversity will lead to more effective flexibility procurement, more effective centralized compliance with NERC and FERC regulations, and just the general increased visibility and situational awareness will, we believe, improve reliability, but again, not quantified in this report. Lastly, the opportunity that's created from the low diversity reducing the overall capacity requirements. That may actually also lead to benefits where there may be some additional capacity that may be available and may be able to be valued more effectively across the integrated balancing area. Again, not quantified, but at least discussed in the report. So with that, I'm going to turn it back over to Phil.
All right. Well, thank you, Mark and Jack, Rick. So we summarized for everyone the high-level benefits. What we wanted to do here in this next couple of slides is just to let you know what the next steps are. The conclusions are to move forward. So from the ISO perspective, we have already put out our stakeholder initiative catalog. It's identifying the roadmap to all of the initiatives that will be conducted under the ISO. But there are certainly five initiatives we've already identified that are necessary to move the ISO from a California as sort of a single state centric ISO to now a multi-state or a regional organization. And so what you see here then is the game plan for those five initiatives. The first one to get started is going to be looking at our transmission access charge and considering how that structure changes as we move to a regional ISO. Resource adequacy rules will follow after that. Again, both of these trying to get started before the end of this year. By the time we get to the early part of next year, in the first quarter, ideally, we're starting the regional integration. And more importantly, what this is a look at the greenhouse gas design that we have, and as Mark was talking about, working effectively in EIM, and take that similar design and move it into the day-ahead market. So we've got similar rules across the real-time and day-ahead. We want to take a look at our metering rules, see what we can do to update those. And then we'll also look at additional enhancements we need to the full network model from a regional perspective. So all of those will get started in different time frames, but ultimately by the time we get into the early part of next year, we'll have all five initiatives running in parallel. Our objective is to have those initiatives completed in the third quarter or early part of the third quarter next year, because then we can actually get those filed with FERC, look for a positive decision there, and then be able to support PacifiCorp in their stakeholder process. And so I wanted to hand it to Carolyn to talk a little bit about what PacifiCorp has in mind in terms of engaging folks from a stakeholder process perspective.
Thanks, Bill. Well, obviously, PacifiCorp will be participating and supporting heavily multiple stakeholder items that Bill just went over. And we really strongly encourage participation from our states and our customers in the ISO stakeholder process, because that's where we'll come up with the best solutions for those items. In order to encourage participation in that, we will be varying locations around the region to facilitate the most amount of participation we can get. And then once the ISO finishes its final schedule, beyond even the stakeholder items that will be conducted in 15 and 16, PacifiCorp will identify any issues that are specific to its customers, its stakeholders, or any areas that require a little bit more detailed discussion and develop a complementary schedule to that to address those issues. But again, that will not be a substitute for participating in the ISO stakeholder process. So just really need to, that's where most of the major items will be determined and solutions for those. In the meantime, PacifiCorp has already been reaching out to state regulators and its customers, and will continue to do so. Over the next month, we'll be making additional outreach to our state regulators to answer any questions they have on this benefit study that's going on today. And then we have a meeting, a stakeholder public meeting set up in January. We will be scheduling one in January, and details of that will be posted on our OASIS and emails to our stakeholders. But to kind of go over the changes that we know will occur, and most of those changes, there will be solutions that will be driven through the stakeholder process.
Okay, thanks, John. So at this point, we wanted to pause and open up the lines for questions, see what questions you have in terms of the high-level results that we've shared with you. We look forward to then answering some of those questions and then moving into our next segment, where we do intend to dive into this more detail and describe how each of these benefit categories were derived and how this came about in terms of the high-level summary. So let's pause for a second and see what initial questions you all may have.
And so just a reminder, you can enter the queue by either raising your hand to the web service or you can press star 1 on your telephone. And please remember to state your name and company representative for asking a question. You guys must have been very thorough. There are no questions.
No questions. Okay.
Are we sure? Are we sure that, that the, you know, the operator is concerned there's no questions?
Yeah, the operator. So, operator,
yeah.
Are there any
questions
in the queue that you can see?
No, there are no questions.
Okay.
Well, let's move on. So, Jack, we're moving into our next segment here. We want to try to dive into a little bit and better understand the analysis that you did for PacifiCorp and ISO.
Yes.
The first thing up was efficient dispatch.
Yes, exactly. So, just as an overview, I think we'll walk through these four items, starting with efficient dispatch and unit commitment. And for each one, we're going to describe it, go into scenario assumptions, and show how those led to the benefits that we identified overall. So go to efficient dispatch. So we mentioned it earlier, but I think digging into a little bit more detail, more efficient unit commitment and dispatch really is the savings from that is a reduction in generation cost as a result of PacifiCorp participating in the day-ahead market. And that includes benefits, and that includes efficiency gains that happen both from optimal unit commitment, from co-optimization of energy and ancillary services, and from having nodal prices in the day-ahead time frame. For quantifying these benefits, overall, the really wanted to focus and make sure that we looked at benefits that are incremental to those already achieved from the EIN. So the EIN study that we published back in March 2013 projected total benefits that range from 21 to over $120 million in savings. So one of the main drivers of the difference is that in the low end, the EIN assumed to only impact savings within the hour. The higher end could project some amount of impact on forward markets as well and impacts on reserves. So more recently, the ISO has published a study estimating the actual benefits from the first few months of participation. And actually, even the June estimate had about $20 million of savings over that time period. So the fundamental question that still remains is difficult to address is how much more savings comes about from these additional operational capabilities that are enabled through full integration and the day ahead. So instead of trying to develop an entirely new tool, we relied on the experience of other markets in going from an EIM or real-time market to a full day-ahead, hour-ahead, and five-minute market with integrated ancillary services into that market to see what their incremental benefits were. So this relied on recent experiences both from STP, longer ago by MISO, and then also more recently in Entergy joining MISO RTO. So overall, we looked at the range of savings that resulted from those cases, and within that range, the low end ended up being about 2% of the overall production cost. That would be both fuel and variable operations and maintenance for those areas overall that were saved from going to a full integrated market. The high end across the studies was a bit over 3%. So we developed this 2 to 3% range of savings that we applied for potential reduction in costs as a result of more efficient unit commitment dispatch. And as Mark said, we did not quantify additional savings for the ISO, mostly due to the assumption that the ISO has already been operating a day-ahead market for a number of years now. And as a result, we decided to be on the conservative end, even though we think that there will be some additional liquidity and trading savings that could potentially result from there. But we applied this 2-3% savings range to the forecasted production cost for PacifiCorp for each year. And the 2 years here, 2024 and 2030, are shown. And this results in a low range of savings savings that are $31 million per year in 2024, going up to $36 million by 2030 for PacifiCorp. And then in the high end, savings ranging around $50 million over that time period and rising as production costs rise. Digging a little more deeply into the savings that and the studies that were used to estimate that savings range, these are the three recent studies that we looked at on slide 14. So the SPP case was a good applicable case, both because it's a very recent experience. They've just completed their transition and had their first full year of fully integrated operations in 2014 and had some experience with for a few years of what they call the EIS, which is equivalent to the EIN at territory for about 5 years preceding that. So their savings range for their projected analysis ranged from about $110 to $170 million a year, which represents about 1.5 to 3.5% of their overall projected production cost over that time period. Slightly longer ago, MISO also made the transition from what they call a day one market to a full day two market with integrated ancillary services. And in making that transition, a ex post study that looked at the efficiency gains, both fuel burn and reductions in production costs that they saw, estimated about 2.5% savings of production costs per year as a result of this transition. Finally, more recently, Entergy, about a year ago, also joined the MISO. And we thought that this was a nice, similar comparison in the sense that it is a large utility that has previously not had had experience with a regional market, transitioning, joining another market that is already operating, already underway. And the projected savings that MISO had range from 2% to 3.5% when they were evaluating the decision to participate, which for their VA, or for their system, represented a range of about $130 to $150 million per year. Their actual experience, I think, has surpass this. Their savings estimates of ex post have been higher than this, but they also include the capacity savings, which address in a separate cap. So overall, this is applied to about $1.5 to $2 billion of production cost annually for PacifiCorp to create the savings we get overall. So transitioning to the next slide, that lower peak capacity savings that we see on slide 15. This, as we said before, is the result of the fact that PacifiCorp and the ISO have load that peaks at different times, often on different days and different hours of the year. As a result, at the time when PacifiCorp needs at the time when PacifiCorp hits their maximum peak, ISO will have generation that's not fully at max at that time period. And similarly, when the ISO is at its system peak, PacifiCorp will typically not be at its own low peak either. As a result, this means that both systems can both meet their system reliability needs with a lower amount of generation capacity in place, which allows for the opportunity for cost savings through deferral or avoidance of new capacity additions or contracts. For valuing this, For the ISO, we looked at the values that SEEK diversity savings would have based on projected resource adequacy costs that transition both from transition starting from current RA contract prices in California up to the cost of new entry for capacity in later years. For PacifiCorp, we value this based on PacifiCorp's IRP's estimated cost of new thermal resource additions that could be displaced, net of market risk. That's based on PacifiCorp's baseline estimates of when those new capacity additions would otherwise be needed, which varies depending on the scenario assumption that we use. So, as mentioned earlier, the low scenario uses PacifiCorp's preferred IRP planned portfolio, which assumes that the first generation capacity additions that would be added would be in 2028. So the first opportunity for capacity displacement as a result of integration would begin at that time. Secondly, under the high scenario, we use a more advanced scenario in which, from a different IRP case that looked at a range of 2024 as the first year in which capacity additions were needed, which allows for this potential opportunity for peak capacity savings to occur sooner, producing more savings over the overall time frame. For both savings, the ISO savings are based on these RA contract prices transitioning to the cost of new entry for combustion turbine gas plants. And that was common across both cases. So overall, this shows the low and high scenario for the ISO being a little over $60 million a year of saving in 2024 and 2023 on peak capacity. And PacifiCorp's savings ranging from 36 million dollars a year over that time period, and 46 to 54 a year. So going to the next slide, just a little bit better illustration of this lower peak capacity need to make sure that everyone is clear on this. This is an illustration of the daily peak demand profile for the ISO and PacifiCorp. And then PacifiCorp's being in the orange series, and the ISO's as the blue line here. Then together, we stack these two together to create the demand profile for the combined footprint, which is the gold profile over the course of the day, which has a slightly different peak hour than either one of the systems. It's the combination of the two. Now, if we were simply to add up the maximum level for the PacifiCorp system and for the ISO system alone, which is typically known as the non-coincident peak between the two systems, you get a level that's actually higher than the combined system if we added them up hourly and looked at the single hour that's the highest level for them together as a coincidence. So overall, as a result, this comparison of the coincidence peak relative to the sum of the non-coincident peaks of the system enable a percentage reduction in the level of peak capacity that's needed. In the ISO, this reduction leads to on the order of 300 megawatts per year under both scenarios, rising to just 302 by 2030 peak capacity for that. This is for the system. It's a little over 700 megawatts of potential peak capacity savings, but there's also two additional limits that play in here on top of that. The first is the transmission transfer capability between the two systems. So which is actually 776 megawatts going from ISO to the PacifiCorp system. Secondly, we assume that the maximum amount of peak capacity deferral and an opportunity for savings would be based on what the baseline capacity additions that are needed would be, which are under the high scenario would be 423 megawatts in 2024, and under the low scenario, under both low and high, would be 736 megawatts by 2030. Going to the next savings category, more efficient overgeneration management on slide 17. Overall, in terms of the concept of this is the fact that so we believe that full coordination and integration of the two systems allow both sides to more flexibly respond to the potential for renewable overgeneration. So, as many of you have heard by now, overgeneration is estimated to be an increasing challenge for efficient operation of the California grid in the future, particularly as we rise past 33% RPS and up to 40%, 50% renewable procurement needs out through 2030. So rather than needing to curtail a larger and larger amount of RPS energy in hours when does not load in California that would be able to receive it, we assume that instead a portion of that potential energy that would otherwise have to be curtailed can instead be more efficiently managed and absorbed by the system. So the amount of curtailment that we estimated was based on and estimated using CPUC's, the California Public Utilities Commission's RPS calculator, which generated a diverse case of renewable resources to build up to 40% RPS in 2024 and 50% RPS in 2030. That identified, as a result, a certain amount of overgeneration that would happen in any given hour, and limited the total amount of overgeneration of that total that could be avoided as a result of integration to the potential transfer capability from the ISO to the PacifiCorp currently. And that overgeneration level and that cap was the 776 megawatts that we have there. Now, overall, that cap is something that could potentially change and could be increased in the future due to integrated transmission planning, but we assumed that current level for the calculation of benefits in the study. So for valuation of savings on a dollars per megawatt hour basis of this quantity of overgeneration, we both included the avoided production costs that would be estimated on the PacifiCorp system, which would be avoided fuel burn and variable O&M for PacifiCorp generators. And as well, we added to the savings the avoided renewable procurement costs in the ISO that could be avoided as a result of not needing to replace overgeneration with additional renewable build and additional renewable procurement to replace it. So overall, the scenario assumptions were the same for the high and low case, but they're driven over the time period by a rising amount of rising California RPS targets. So a 40% RPS in 2024 that we model results in 467 gigawatt hours of potential overgeneration exported to PacifiCorp. And in 2030, 50% RPS ups that to a little under 1,500 gigawatt hours of potential overgeneration for the year that could be exported.
Jack, let me interrupt you there. I want to let everybody know on the line, we are aware that there is an issue with the webinar software, and we've got a solution. We do want to take your questions. And so, Christina, why don't you tell everybody how we want to receive their questions so we can try to be responsive.
Sure. So what you can do is actually send your question to the operator. It's listed as ATTCES, and she will forward that note to me, and I'll read the question out loud. And please, operator, if you can let me know who's asking the question and where they're, you know, what company they represent. And you can also email those questions to me. So as we pause, I can check my email as well as the chat messages that come in. So we do apologize that the we're not able to take your questions verbally.
So, Christina, if you're saying they can email directly to you, where
we are.
Where?
Oh, sorry. Pardon the interruption. This is the operator. We are able to take verbal questions. I can still unlock everyone's lines one at a time according to who has submitted that they have a verbal question to ask.
So you can see the hands raised?
No, I'm not able to see who raised their hands. If you have a question, you can send
I see what you're saying.
Me.
I see what you're
yes,
saying.
Yes, and then I
okay.
can still go ahead and unlock that person's line according to their name.
I got you. So just have them submit their name, let
yes.
you know they have a question, and you can unlock their line. Okay, that works great.
So, all right, so let's come back. So how do we want to handle this, Christina?
Let's have, so what you want to do is if you have a question, send a note to the operator letting her know, and she'll unmute your phone line manually. So she's not able to see the hands raised, so you just have to send her a chat message. So, operator, if you are receiving questions, do you want to pause now, Phil, and take questions now, or do you want to wait until he's finished with the quantified benefits section?
Yeah. Well, from what I understand, we actually had a couple of higher-level questions from our first segment. So why don't we try to answer those? I think there were only a couple of them, and then maybe we can come back and let you sort of finish.
Sure.
So, operator, I'm understanding there were two questions that, of folks that wanted to ask. Can folks get that note to the operator, see if we can handle those?
Yes, there were actually about three people who wanted to ask questions during the first segment. So
okay.
The first person was Travis. So, Travis, please go ahead.
Hi, this is Travis Ritchie with the Sierra Club. Can folks hear me?
Yes, thank you.
So, my first question was on the quantification of the more efficient unit commitment metric. And you actually ended up explaining this a little bit more in the second segment, but so it was based on a literature review and assumed a broad 2-3% savings based on what we'd seen in other places. But has PacifiCorp or the ISO done any dispatch level modeling to consider the unit specific response to integration particular to California system? And I think specifically, you know, a lot of the other systems you looked at don't have this large overgeneration issue. And so I'm curious how those two will interact with each other and whether that was looked at.
Yeah, Travis, this is Jack. So we haven't undertaken a large production simulation modeling exercise for this particular analysis. The reason driving that is that we really wanted to focus on what's incremental to the EIM. And given the large uncertainty band around the total potential savings in the EIM, there's not really a long enough history to establish what could be added, sort of what to model into that for production simulation model. And I think the point that you bring up, Travis, is a good one about higher overgeneration potential. I think that is a difference in the two systems, and I think probably is something that could even be potentially conservative on that level of benefit that we have there, in the sense that those other systems, while they have, they do have renewables, they wouldn't have it over the quantities that we're projecting and the concentration they're projecting over this time frame.
Mark, did you have anything to add?
Yeah, as I mentioned earlier, I think as part of our SB 350 work effort, we will likely endeavor into some additional simulations there that would get after this question about what would the redispatch result in terms of the differences and the impacts on greenhouse gases. I think there is at least some explanation in the report that discusses that the expectation would be that the overgeneration, oversupply in California and the efficient dispatch of that overgeneration will likely lead to at least some displacement, probably renewable to gas. And I think also which would result in some reduction of greenhouse gases, and there was some estimated quantification of about 0.2 to 0.6 million metric tons if there was at least that renewable to gas displacement. But in addition to that, we do expect that there would probably be most likely some gas to gas displacement occurring in the short term. In the short term, I don't think we're expecting to have a large amount of displacement of coal redispatch, because in most cases the coal is most likely going to be having operating at high capacity factors, not coming to California, but basically already serving loads outside of California. And so there isn't, at least in the short term, an expectation of a large amount of coal redispatch or displacement. But I think, as I described earlier, that in the longer term, as the Clean Power Plan is executed and there will be opportunities where this integration, regional integration, will provide potential opportunities for doing that in a more effective way. But that's probably in the longer term, and then, not again, not quantified in this report.
Just one quick follow-up. Haven't, in the literature studies for some of those other integrated markets, when we looked at those, we actually saw that existing fleets are benefited when you, at least on for capacity payments, when you go to integration. And so could we see, as we've seen in the other areas, an increase of coal dispatch that we saw in other areas? I think you noted this in your report as a possibility.
Hey, Travis. This is Travis. This is Rick Link. I think you mentioned this capacity payment concept, and I think it's worth noting that if there's any benefits, which we had noted in the report, that there could be some benefits on a capacity side, and there could be capacity revenues that weren't entirely quantified for PacifiCorp in the near term in the RA market per se. But none of those factors would influence in any fashion the actual dispatch or energy production from the assets if there are those benefits. It's more of a fixed cost trade-off versus an energy and an optimal dispatch scenario. As Mark alluded to earlier, we would expect that, or we do know that the coal generation is already relatively low cost to other alternatives in the system. It's operating at essentially its full capability, and by virtue of simply having a day-ahead market in place to more optimally handle dispatch across the systems, we would not expect any really incremental or material things over the, or material increases in generation from those coal units over the long term.
Okay. Operator, can we move on to the next question?
Yes. The next question is from David. Please go ahead.
Hi. This is Dave Marcus for CURE, which is a coalition of electric utility unions. I had a question about slide 9 asking when and where the SB 350 analysis will fit into the list of upcoming initiatives.
Well, thank you, Dave. This is Phil Pattengill. Let me answer that question. I think there's probably other folks that are curious about the overall SB 350 effort. I think you can appreciate that this benefit study was conducted really before SB 350 came out. So the way to answer your question is this study, couldn't and didn't identify what would be needed until 350 was passed and, of course, signed by the governor last week. We're in the process of planning that out right now, but as I mentioned earlier, it certainly is our intention to conduct additional studies as are required under 350, and certainly some of this discussion, as Mark touched on, about looking at what's the incremental change in dispatch of resources, we are anticipating that we would do actual some production simulation in order to be able to identify those incremental changes. In terms of the governance question, which I'm sure is on everybody's mind, we do need to look at what SB 350 lays out, and that is
to do those studies first, then work with our board and the state and the other state agencies through, you know, in PacifiCorp service territory to come up with a governance framework. And then ultimately we come together into a workshop that's hosted by the PUC, CARB, and CEC. And in that multi-agency workshop, give the ISO an opportunity to present what we found in those studies, as well as a proposed governance framework. We are anticipating to try to do that work next year in 2016. But any more detail, we just really have not been able to flesh out a specific schedule.
Okay, so okay. I should think of that SB 350 as being then a sixth stakeholder policy initiative with a planned start being in 2016?
Well, yeah, although it's at this point, again, it's unclear. You know, the ISO governance process is likely to have a stakeholder process. But in terms of doing these studies, again, we haven't really figured out exactly how to do that. There will be a lot of public transparency because of that multi-state agency workshop. But we do intend to develop those studies, have a robust conversation with all the stakeholders, and then you know, proceed with the other elements of SB 350. Okay?
Okay. Now, operator? I had some.
Yes, our next question is from Michael Gibbs.
Michael.
Please go ahead.
Presentation today. My question was regarding, this was actually not from the first segment, but was from the second, regarding the more efficient unit commitment and dispatch, and whether it's possible to tease out whether a portion of those savings are associated with improved dispatch by PacifiCorp that could be achieved on its own without integration, and what portion is specific to the integration itself and really requires integration to achieve. Thanks.
Jack?
So the portion of savings that could be achieved without integration, I mean, I think this almost entirely looks at the savings that are achieved through integration itself.
This is Mark Ruff. But remember, these are already incremental to the energy imbalance market. So there you get some efficient real-time dispatch. This is in addition to that, and it really is reliant on the integration to achieve those.
Yeah, I guess, Michael, we didn't try to prove the counterfactual, I guess, right? What could PacifiCorp do without an integration? This was all about looking forward, and that's what the benefits are trying to identify.
Yeah. Yeah, just adding to that, the EIM analysis had $20 to $120 million of savings per year that was estimated in that separate EIM study back in 2013, and it's gotten about 20 in the first month of operation thus far.
Okay. Operator, next one.
Our next question is from Kevin.
Go ahead, Kevin.
Please go ahead.
Chairman, can you hear me?
Yes, we got you.
Okay. I have two questions, both on the sort of the first half. One is a follow-up to the question David Marcus asked. He asked sort of about the SB 350 study. I'm more curious about sort of what happens to this study at this point. I mean, this is sort of a preliminary study, and you could sort of drop it and move on from here, I suppose. But I also noticed in slide 26 you say, questions can be sent through Friday, October 30th, so it makes me kind of wonder if this study sort of takes on a life of its own, you know. So what happens to this study at this point?
This is Mark Rother. This is Mark Rother. I guess from this study perspective, this study is complete, and it really does kick off the next steps, which are really what's outlined in terms of the policy stakeholder next steps, as well as for PacifiCorp, their steps in terms of their state-by-state stakeholder processes. So the reason that we did the open up to the questions was we realized that there may be additional questions just on the material that comes up after the call, and we wanted to at least provide some opportunity to answer those questions, not really hold open the study as some
right.
kind of preliminary study. It's the study's complete. We are moving on to the next steps.
Yeah, because some of the comments or questions might actually give you some good ideas about what to do in the next step.
Yeah.
The other question was, it's not on the slides, but you've mentioned it a couple of times, is the impact of the energy imbalance market on greenhouse gases. And Mark, you talked about the transfers of energy into California are, you know, very few of them are, you know, supported by coal. And that's, I gather you do that to sort of verify that the California Air Resources Board reporting requirements are met or standards are met. I just wanted to know, have you tried to put together the data on the impact of the EIM and on greenhouse gas emissions across the entire EIM footprint?
It's difficult to do that because really it's not clear what the counterfactual would be at that point, and there's other factors that come into play, whether it be seasonal changes, other operating changes that have occurred, and at the very least there would have to be some kind of normalization of those other factors. So we don't have that ability at this point to do that analysis of what would have been the greenhouse gas dispatch across the entire footprint, but we are able, through the mechanisms of tracking the transfers to California, we at least can quantify the resources supporting the transfers to California, and that's directly from the results of the EIM dispatch.
But you estimate the benefits, which involves a counterfactual dispatch, and looking at all the changes in units, the dollar benefits. I don't see why soaking up the factual and counterfactual dispatches of all the units in the West, why you can't do that. It just doesn't, I don't get it.
Yeah. Kevin, I think this probably is a more extensive discussion. Maybe we can take this offline, but it's one thing to do an economic counterfactual. We have the bids. We know the resource bids, and we can use that for the counterfactual. We don't have all the counterfactual, but the emission dispatch would be.
But you do have emission dispatches for all the units in the EIM footprint. You have their...
I have a greenhouse gas adder as represented as part of the bid. I do not have the greenhouse emissions from every resource in the EIM area.
Okay, I thought I read something that you did. Anyway, okay, we'll take this up later.
Okay.
Great. Thank you. Hi, operator. I think Bonnie Blair from Six Cities had a question. She sent me an email but is unable to send you a note. So can you open up her phone line, please?
Yes, Bonnie, please go ahead.
Hi, I have two questions, I guess. One has to do with the capacity benefits estimate. I take it that's based entirely on capacity needed to meet system peak. And so the question is that there are other drivers for capacity procurement in the ISOBA, at least, and one of those is local capacity and another one is flexible capacity. Have you done any sort of a sensitivity analysis to see to what extent those other drivers would affect the estimated capacity savings based on the peak?
No, Bonnie, we haven't. The local capacity and the flexible capacity would be also needed, but this would mostly affect the portion of the capacity that's not needed for local reasons or flexibility reasons.
And correct me if I'm wrong, but there is a limit on the amount of that benefit by the transfer capability between the two systems. So it's the total diversity of the load is in excess of the amount that was taken credit for, which would be limited by the transfer.
That's right. Yeah.
For PacifiCorp side.
Yeah, okay.
And Bonnie, this is Phil Pettengill. I just wanted to add to that answer for your first part of your question is not only was there that transfer limitation that limits the benefit, but also part of the reason why we highlighted in the stakeholder processes that are coming up, that second line item you see there, is we do need to look at the resource adequacy rules and try to make sure that there is some, you know, comparability, should we say, because as you know, one of the principles of resource adequacy is just to make sure that the load-serving entities are not leaning on each other, that they are providing sufficient capacity to meet their needs. And that would be the intention in that stakeholder initiative.
Okay, that helps. And then my second question goes to the, I need a little help understanding conceptually how overgeneration would lead to additional procurement of renewable capacity. Is the idea that if you have energy curtailment during periods of overgeneration, that you would have to add renewable capacity in order to produce more renewable energy during other periods when it could be absorbed? Is that the concept?
Yes, that's exactly the concept.
Okay, I got it then. Thank you very much.
Sure. All right, operator, are there any other questions? Just a reminder that queue isn't working, so if you do have a question, if you could just send a note to the operator, ATTCES, and she'll open up your phone line. Sorry, go ahead, operator.
The next question is from David. Please go ahead.
I had a question about slide 17.
David, let me interrupt you. I'm sorry. Who are you with? Your name and who are you with?
Oh, sorry. Dave Marcus from CURE. You answered a question for me about slide 9 earlier.
All right, fair enough. Just wanted to make sure we knew. Thank you.
No, I realize there are quite a few Davids on this call. First of all, as I'm sure you know, there's a typo there. The sum of 138 plus 138 is 276, not 176. In the technical appendix, of that $276 million, $221 million is the savings from the avoided procurement that Bonnie Blair was just asking about, the 1,449 gigawatt hours that would have to be replaced since they had been curtailed. A $221 million savings from 1,449 gigawatt hours works out to $152 a megawatt hour, which is much higher than the costs for renewable procurement that are shown elsewhere in the report. And I wondered if you could speak to where that $221 million number comes from.
Yeah, David. So the $152 a megawatt hour reflects the fact that incremental procurement that would be needed when you're already, for instance, at 50% RPS, would itself have curtailment of some of the hours that you're facing. So a separate study that we had done in 2014 had estimated that under a high RPS scenario, you could be up to as much as 60% incremental curtailment for additional resources that are added, additional renewable resources that are added if they're producing in those hours when there's already curtailment happening. And so as a result, to get the same quantity of renewable energy, you have to build more capacity. And so the average dollars per megawatt hour of those incremental replacement units of renewable energy that you get ends up having a higher overall cost. Yeah, so that gets to that $152 a megawatt hour cost overall.
So you're effectively saying the marginal cost in 2030 of incremental net generation, net of curtailment, will be $152 a megawatt hour in 2015 dollars.
Right.
Which means in nominal dollars, it'd be around $200 a megawatt hour.
Yes. Yeah, I mean, for a little bit more implication of that, so if you're looking at something like a $75 a megawatt hour megawatt hour cost for just the energy itself, and if you're having to sell half of that for that incremental procurement, then that means that sort of for each incremental megawatt hour that you don't also curtail, your cost ends up being about half of that, or it ends up being about twice of that, should be up to that $152 number.
Okay. And I don't know if there's other people in the queue, because I had one question each on each of the preceding slides, but I will drop out and wait if other people have questions.
We do have other people in the queue, but please feel free to go to the questions in the room.
Actually, hold on a second, operator. What I'd really like to do is, Jack, can we ask you to try to finish up these next few slides? We were trying to get through the details here. See if we can move through these next few slides just so we finished our second segment, and then we can open up this queue and try to answer all the questions, because folks are really answering questions in our more detailed discussion. It sounds like we've cleared the questions from the high level. See what you can do. Let's move through these next few slides if folks are okay with that, and then we'll come back and open up this queue and really answer all the questions we can. Okay, Jack?
Okay. That's great. So I think that we're going to slide 18 here.
Yeah.
So the conceptual illustration of more efficient open generation management. This slide view on the top, it shows a typical day with high levels of overgeneration prior to operation. So what you have in green is the output of renewable resources by hour over the course of the day. You see the familiar sort of duck-shaped profile for remaining need for thermal generation resources, which is a great area there. Going down to essentially the minimum level of thermal generation that you can have during the middle part. And when you hit that low level of sort of that minimum level of potential thermal generation resources, you end up also with additional renewable resources that you can. So the red area at the top of that upper left chart represents the overgeneration that would be needed to be curtailed in a non-integration scenario. Meanwhile, in this non-integration scenario, PacifiCorp's generation during that same middle part of the day continues to run at a relatively flat level and doesn't see the impact of what's going on in California. By contrast, in the bottom two charts, we show what happens with that export capability from the ISO to PacifiCorp in an integration in an integrated system. And overall, rather than having the full amount of the red area be curtailed, instead you have a higher level of export from the ISO to PacifiCorp. There's still a portion of curtailment if and when that maximum export capability of 776 megawatts gets hit for exports, but you're exporting a portion of that. And PacifiCorp, meanwhile, backs down its thermal resources at the same time, reducing the amount of fuel burn on those resources and having imports, which is the dark blue area that's in the upper middle part of that lower right chart. So finishing up with the final category, number four on slide 19, of renewable procurement savings. Overall, as we had said, this is the resulting savings that come as a result of full coordination of transmission planning that allows for resources to be procured by each entity at a lower cost than could happen in a non-integrated scenario. So overall, we estimated the savings here based on the difference resource and transmission costs in scenarios that included and excluded Wyoming wind as a low cost. For valuing these savings for the ISO,
We based it on the California RPS calculator, which either included or excluded those Wyoming resources as an option from the resource supply curve at estimated cost that includes the transmission. For the Pacific Corp system, we estimated it based on the relative cost of Wyoming wind, including the transmission associated with it, compared to other renewables that are available to Pacific Corp and its IRP and the cost associated with that. So in the low scenario, as we've mentioned, we excluded the savings category overall. That reflects a number of things. On the Pacific Corp side, reflects uncertainty about the requirements in additional renewable procurement that are needed. And in the ISO side, it also reflects that transmission and procurement are competitively determined, and so that could potentially not be the direction that this goes. So the savings in the high scenario include the savings category, and largely, depending on the different year, they're driven by the rising RPS target in California and the amount of procurement that can come from the land. So for 2024, that ends up working out to a bit under 900 megawatts of Wyoming wind that goes to PacifiCorp and a little over 2,000 megawatts that go to the ISO. By 2030, this rises to a little under 1,100 megawatts to PacifiCorp and more than 2,500 megawatts of Wyoming wind that go to the ISO. Again, this is only a high case or high scenario savings where this is included, and gives a range of $28 to $54 million a year, a range going up from 2024 to 2030, from $28 to $54 million for PacifiCorp. As for the ISO in 2024, it's $121 million of savings, rising to 691 by 2030. That rise in for the ISO in particular has a lot to do with the fact that the alternative resources are that California is essentially moving up the supply curve of other resources that could get procured by 2030, and the amount of overgeneration in state is also growing, which increases the cost of those resources. Slide 20 just wraps up with an illustration of this impact and shows the combination of at the top it shows the individual renewable resource supply curves of potential renewable energy in the ISO region and in the Pacific Corp region. And in the Pacific Corp region, a good portion at the lower end of those resources, high quality, high capacity factor Wyoming wind, which is the dark area in its supply curve. When you expand the footprint, you combine these two supply curves, the expanded supply curve has that Wyoming wind a far less low cost area of the overall supply curve and is available for both entities to procure.
Thanks, Jack. So we're on slide 21, and what slide 21 is trying to illustrate is out of that procurement benefit, it really compares the capacity of the two procurements. In the low case, what the procurement would be to achieve 50%, and in the high case, with the 2,500 megawatts of Wyoming wind. I think a couple of things to emphasize on this is that even in the low case without the Wyoming wind, this scenario starts from a presumption that we have a diversified California portfolio, which is a departure from what I'd call business as usual, which would have been likely a higher solar build-out in California. And what that means, though, is that starting from a more diversified portfolio in California, the overall benefits that are defined here are not as high as what they may have would have been had you looked at the business as usual case as the counterfactual, the low case. The other thing to point out is that this diversified portfolio does have a significant amount of build in California. It's about 1,400 megawatts in geothermal, 6,000 megawatts of PV, and 4,600 megawatts of non-Wyoming wind in that low case without the Wyoming wind. And really, it's the as a result of the 2,500 megawatts of Wyoming wind, you get that benefit of reduced curtailment, which translates into having to build overall less capacity, and you get a resource that has higher capacity factors, so you're able to achieve the 50% at a lower cost. And that's translated into that about 876 megawatts of reduced capacity to achieve the 50%. And as I just want to emphasize one more time that as Jack indicated, the review and the consideration of the Wyoming wind does consider the potential transmission costs that would come from an integrated transmission planning to achieve that Wyoming wind being interconnected to a California balancing area, an integrated balancing area, and therefore would be counting towards 50% renewables. So with that, I'm sure we'll have more questions, but I'll pass it along to, I think, Rick at this point.
Well, actually, what we wanted to do here and what I had proposed is let's stop now. We've given a high-level overview, and we've sort of taken our deep dive into how the calculations were performed. And so let's stop here and see what additional questions you have, and then we'll move into the last segment, which is sort of to wrap up and see where we go from here. So let's, operator, what questions do you have on the line?
Before you open up the phone lines, just a reminder, please state your name and the company you represent. And also, I know that Carrie Bentley from WPCF sent me a note via email saying she had a question. So if you can start with her, she's been trying to get in the queue for a while.
Okay, we can go to Carrie, and then after Carrie will be Jason.
Great.
Carrie, please go ahead.
Hi, this is Carrie Bentley from Rosero Consulting. I had a question on the joint transmission planning process in the Wyoming wind. I was just wondering whether there was anything incremental to what the ISO might do in terms of joint transmission planning anyway. And it seems to me you don't actually need grid integration to do joint transmission planning. I mean, the RPS calculator already shows, you know, it's being beneficial to get some of this Wyoming wind. So I was wondering if you did any sensitivities around what, you know, realistically might be done jointly and come from Wyoming and whatnot. Because I think in the paper, the technical appendix seems to say no Wyoming, you know, it's an all or nothing scenario. So just wondering if you looked into that a little more.
Yeah, Carrie, one thing that's important to note, I think, for the joint is that there's a big economies of scale that results from both of these entities working together to procure the Wyoming wind. The overall size of the transmission development has and the costs related to it are, I think, lower per megawatt hour for a larger development. Additionally, it enables resources and renewable procurement to go to the closest local loads and reaching the overall system, the overall integrated system, rather than having to necessarily build transmission to bring it to a, sort of the opposite end of the overall system. Yeah.
Okay.
Question is from Jason. Please go ahead.
Hi, this is Meredith Young-Hein, and there are many of us at the CPC in a room together. So my first question, can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay. We tried to ask this at the very beginning, but for your capacity avoided costs, we were wondering what assumptions you were making about California's resource adequacy program and our planning reserve margin and our limitation on the amount of imports that can count for our resource adequacy. capacity requirements in order to calculate your large benefit from avoided capacity needs in the future?
Well, Carrie, what we did in the study, and Jack, tell me if I've got this wrong, but what I understand that we did was we simply looked at what's the peak load of PacifiCorp's system, what's the peak load of the California ISO system, and looked at how their non-coincidence, you know, would generate a higher number. So when we bring them together and look at what the coincident peak is, there's simply a lower capacity that's required to serve that coincident peak load. Right? I mean, so
you assume that nothing would change about our RA rules. So this avoided capacity need is 100% based on reduced coincident peak and not a reduced planning reserve margin or a reduced
That's correct, Meredith. Our tariff, as you know, gives great deference to local regulatory authority, and at this point we have no intention of changing those provisions, and so the provisions that you have under the CPUC we envision would be the same under an integrated balancing authority.
And the second part that's related is how did you avoid double counting of the avoided capacity and then your avoided renewable capacity, because you have them in two different categories?
Yeah, so for the renewable capacity, we're looking only at the energy or the cost for the renewable characteristics of that, rather than counting it towards the capacity need.
Yeah, the way to think about that is really back to where we were talking about, just peak load, how much capacity is needed for peak load, and as Jack described, how much capacity is needed to get from a 33 to a 50% RPS. Looking at it from an effective energy standpoint. So that's why we differentiated the two in order to identify where those savings or those benefits are being derived.
Okay. So you're not including reduced renewable capacity needs in the overall reduced, or you are including them in the overall reduced capacity need that you calculated. Because obviously renewable capacity is capacity, right?
No, at that point, we don't feed that. We don't feed that for renewable.
We have one other question in the room here.
My question just on the basic load forecast being used. I'm assuming since the timing of this and the sources that you did not assume any change in the load curve based on the PUC adopting TOU rates and seeing some impact on the load curve on that. And you also didn't include the AB 350 AAEB impacts. Is that correct?
Yeah, no, we didn't reflect that.
Okay, so to the extent that those impacted the load curve, that might decrease some of the benefits in this study.
I don't know. We'll have to see what that load projection would be.
Yeah, I guess the way to think about this, Robert, is that we could only make assumptions based on what's already in play. And as we said earlier in the call, we didn't even know what would happen under 350, so we could not consider what the implications were. And certainly whatever changes may be made in terms of time of use rates, we were unable to make many considerations there as well. So we worked with what was the status quo when the study began.
But there'd still be likely diversity in terms of timing of peak, whether it be time of the year and time of the day, that could still have some realized diversity benefits of that peak diversity.
And just to track on the point that Meredith was making, you didn't count, or essentially in the study, all the new renewables you're counting as energy only, as not having capacity value that would change the capacity needs of the system, which would affect that cost of new generation that's built into the calculating the capacity benefits.
Mm-hmm. Well, that capacity is the same under both the base case and the change case, and so we don't have a differential between these two different cases.
All I'm saying is,
Robert,
when you go to 50% capacity, 50% renewables, you're entering a whole large amount of new renewables on the system that if they were deliverable, would have capacity value that would change the timing of when the system would need to build new generation or the cost of the market price of capacity on the system.
And the current policy in California is that new renewables will come online as fully deliverable. I mean, that hasn't...
That's not the policy.
Okay, sorry.
That's the practice.
That's the current practice, and it hasn't yet changed. So that's what I was trying to ask about the double counting.
Yep. So Robert, this is Phil, and Jack, correct me if I've got any misunderstanding here, but I think the way to answer your question is the renewable build-out that's in the study was looking at these resources from an energy-only perspective. And the reason to think about it that way is we really didn't incorporate any transmission costs that would be necessary to make it deliverable. There was some... So, Jack, correct.
We did include transmission costs to make it deliverable, but I think that would be... We don't have a differential in that between the case with or without landing procurement. So it's the same on both.
The point is that the capacity contribution to RA would be similar mm-hmm. in the low or the high scenario case because you're getting capacity to meet the RPS. I think the question is that since you're meeting that RPS going to 50%, how much of the capacity was worth anything, and that would have affected the capacity benefit of the reduce or the diversity of the load. And I think the answer is you didn't make any feedback loop of that capacity meeting the 50% necessarily adjusted the year of the capacity need or the value of the capacity to meet the need in the future years. Is that right?
That's right.
Okay.
All right, we'll go ahead and take the next question.
Our next question is from Doug. Please go ahead, and please remember to state your name and company.
Doug Larson, DL Energy. And for the quantified benefits in the study, so what factors would cause these benefits to be significantly higher or lower than what was studied? This is sort of carry on from the past conversation here. For example, if NV Energy were to join the regional ISO and the transfer capacity gets well above 776, I assume benefits would go up substantially. What other kind of factors would drive benefits up? And similarly, what kind of factors which weren't quantified could significantly drive down the benefits that are identified in the study?
So I think we might have to extend the webinar by about an hour and a half on this one, Doug. No, I'm just kidding. But there are, I think this is Rick, PacifiCorp. I think there are a whole host of things, and it probably varies by benefit category in terms of which item you want to look at. You know, for example, the first benefit category that Jack walked us through on efficient unit commitment and dispatch savings, relying on the experience that has happened at MISO and energy's participation there, et cetera, as a percentage of essentially production cost on the PacifiCorp system. Anything that would increase production costs per se, so things like higher gas prices, things of that nature, that would make that underlying, I'll call it benchmark case, a higher cost scenario, and you take a 2% of that or 3% of that would increase that benefit category. And likewise, just in the other direction, if production cost on the base case without integration were to fall, let's say with reduced commodity prices in fuel, coal, natural gas, et cetera, you might see a reduction in that number. So there's some sensitivity to commodity prices, I'd say, on that category. When you move into other categories, if you kind of step through them at a high level, things like renewable procurement cost savings, this last category, when you look at the key drivers to that, the actual cost of renewables going forward, if there are reductions in capital cost or improvements in efficiency, those sorts of things over the long term, especially a 20-year horizon, could have some influence on the answers that were calculated. Commodity prices play a role in that overgeneration category because the assumption is that energy flows out of the ISO. As the chart that Jack walked us through, that graphic, you see reduced overgeneration. PacifiCorp is assumed to be able to back down fossil generation at a savings of fuel and operating costs. So those elements of gas prices and things like that play into that scenario, and it could go either direction. And I think these are just kind of off the cuff a few things that I'm thinking of. I could probably go down a pretty significant laundry list on these, but I think these are some of the key elements that I would characterize as things that could move the dial one way or the other.
Yeah, and I mentioned a couple earlier. I think that these benefits are on the capacity side. I assume a kind of a diversified mix of resources built in California. If that was not a diversified mix, you may see higher benefits, but the overall cost of procurement may be higher, but you see incremental benefits of the value of the regional integration. I think the other thing is, if you go back to look at the non-quantified benefits, you'll find some things there that allude to potentially higher benefits. For example, the integrated transmission plan may end up resulting in increasing overall transfer capabilities into California in an efficient way, which I think would translate into additional benefits, because some of these benefits are limited by the transfer capability. For example, the peak capacity benefits are limited by that transfer capability. So if the integration leads to higher transfer capability from a regional transmission plan, there you could get some additional benefits. So I think those are the things probably to look towards.
Thanks.
Thank you. Operator, we'll take the next question.
Our next question is from Shirley. Please go ahead.
Yes, this is Shirley Eschbach from Tacoma Power. And I have a question back on your slides 9 and 10, the early part of the presentation, talking about the stakeholder initiatives. And I know that California ISO is planning one on the transmission access charge, but my question is, I think, specifically to PacifiCorp, given that becoming a participating transmission owner, you're going to be converting all of your use of your transmission system to purchasing under the CAISO's tariff, and that you currently have an ODE in place that has a contract path service that you provide. You're going to have to be converting those, as well as honoring the existing transmission arrangements and contracts and service agreements that you have in place. I'm wondering where, in what stakeholder process, are you going to be addressing that issue?
Sarah Edmonds. Hi, this is Sarah Edmonds, Vice President and General Counsel for PacifiCorp Transmission. I can answer this question. In the slide addressing next steps, we talked about PacifiCorp setting up a meeting to be determined in terms of the specific date and location, or whether it will be a webinar for January, where we intend to walk through at a high level some of these conversion issues if PacifiCorp integrates into the ISO, with respect to how its transmission customers do business on the system today and how that might look in the future. So we intend to kick that off in January. And in terms of next steps, we're still developing that schedule. We appreciate any comments in that regard about what that should entail, but we feel that there is important emphasis placed on transmission access charge and some of the other five stakeholder streams that the ISO has discussed and will be scheduling, and we will develop a complementary schedule that gets to those issues, shares information, and allows our stakeholders to provide input and feedback on next steps, but a lot of the schedule is yet to be determined.
Okay, good. Thank you. That was very helpful.
All right, next question.
Our next question is from Andy. Please go ahead.
Hi, it's Andy Brown at Ellison, Schneider & Harris. I had a question on the RPS benefits. Were you guys assuming that for those resources that are located outside of California, that they get PCC1 classification simply by the interconnection on the integrated BA, or was it, not in the consideration during that benefit review?
Yeah, Andy, this is Phil. the way the analysis was done, this is sort of important, but going back to sort of my opening remarks, is we assumed it was a single balancing authority, and as a result, we were using current law, which then envisioned that with the ISO coming together with PacifiCorp, the ISO balancing authority would move out then to encompass the other five states, including Wyoming. So the short answer to your question is it would still count as bucket one, given the way current law works.
Okay, so you're reading the definition of California balancing authority to include locations outside California in the single balancing, integrated balancing authority is primarily serving California.
Well, no, I wouldn't say that. The integrated balancing authority is serving all customers, including PacifiCorp customers. It goes back to the definition of a California balancing authority in current law. And the way we're interpreting it is expanding the Cal ISO as we know it now to a regional ISO would still, under current law, be determined as a California balancing authority. And as a result, the wind resources that are in PacifiCorp service territory in Wyoming would be a bucket one resource.
Okay. Well, when it may be more of a legal issue. When I look at the definition, it seemed to be one that is sort of based on square miles of the BA being primarily Californian. But you've answered it in terms of the assumption that they're all PCC ones. My other question was, to the extent you're seeing increases in geothermal, is that addressing the issue that because if you had a lot of resources with overlapping and production time and limited dispatchability, that the price moves up and then captures more geothermal that has more of a baseload renewable production?
Yeah, Andy, the geothermal is selected by the RPS calculator, I think its profile does impact selection.
Okay, thank you.
Operator, before you open up the next line, we are planning to take a little extra time, maybe 15 minutes or so after the hour, because we did have issues with the web service. So, if you have time to stay on, we'd like to address everybody's questions. So, operator, you can go ahead and open up the phone line.
Our next question is from David. Please go ahead.
Hi, this is Dave Marcus. Again, Andy Brown asked half of my question, but I have a follow-up. If you assumed that the bucket one, the PCC one definition, remained at its current footprint after integration with PacifiCorp, so that wind from Wyoming would not necessarily be bucket one, but might have to be delivered to load in, say, Utah, and then be bucket two or bucket three, it seems like that would have no effect on the conclusions, because the conclusions shown in the technical appendix work out that about 8.5% of the RPS obligation will be met by Wyoming wind and another 10% by other non-California renewables, and the sum of those two is well below the 25% allowable under current rules for non-bucket one procurement. Am I reading that correctly, that even if you assume no change in the bucket one geographical footprint, all of the benefits calculated in the study would still be achievable?
David, I think that depends a lot. I think that's one way to interpret it. I think it depends a lot on what else is going on with the rest of the remaining procurement.
That's what slide 21 is about, is telling us what's going on. So in slide 21, would that produce more than 25% not of renewables outside the current bucket one footprint? I mean, all I know is what you put in the study, but what you put in the study says it would not.
Right. So that slide shows the resource build, but there could be additional RECs that are continuing on, rec contracts that are additional to that.
Well, okay, so let me re-ask the question now. You identify Wyoming by gigawatt hour, not by megawatt, but by gigawatt hour, in the technical appendix, and it works out to be just under 8.5%. You have a footnote that says roughly 10% of the RPS is being met with non-California, although you don't split that into non-California bucket one and non-California not bucket one. But as a worst case, assume it was all not bucket one. 10 plus 8.5 is less than 25. What am I missing? Why would there be any obstacle to importing wind from Wyoming with the integration, even if the bucket one footprint remained as it is today?
I think in part the integration does, again, afford the ability to do that regional planning, both transmission and procurement planning, and as a result would allow this to potentially show through as a project, including potential transmission, to get it integrated to that integrated balancing area. And if it wasn't for that, it's not clear whether that outcome would occur.
Yeah, no, I'm not disputing that. I'm saying, assuming the integration occurs at PacifiCorp and the ISO, but as Andy Brown suggested, without a change in the definition of the geographical footprint of the bucket one definition, wouldn't you still get the benefits that you're calculating here? Wouldn't you still be able to do joint development by PacifiCorp and the ISO of Wyoming Wind? Wouldn't you still be able to deliver using the transmission segments identified in your study, which go to Utah and Idaho, to deliver that Wyoming Wind to Utah and Idaho? And wouldn't that still comply with the California RPS rules, even if it wasn't bucket one, because the RPS rules allow for 25% of the procurement to be non-bucket one? So that the benefit that's created by the integration is achievable, even if the integration doesn't include a change to the bucket one geographic definition.
Yeah, Dave, this is Phil Pattengill. One of the things that we're going to do is we'd really like to receive questions and comments from folks, and I do think we need to move along. We've got a number of folks still in the queue. There's a lot of hypothesis we could make here, but we do need to move along. We'd like to encourage you to send us your questions, and we'll see what we can try to do to respond to those.
Okay, our next question is from David. Please go ahead.
Are you there, David? Are you, we'll take the next caller in queue.
David, your line is open. Please go ahead.
Operator, I think we've already addressed David's question, so can you take the next?
Right. This is another David.
Another David.
We've got a lot of David.
Okay. Sorry about that, David.
David, can you please make sure your phone is unmuted, and if you can hear us, please go ahead. Your line is open.
Yes, sorry. Can you hear me?
Yeah, hi, Dave.
Hi. My question is about double counting between the efficient overgeneration management benefit and the renewable energy procurement benefit. In the overgeneration management benefit, some of them come from renewable energy procurement costs, basically avoiding the need to overbuild renewables. And then the renewable energy procurement benefit is kind of a similar. The source of the benefits coming from a similar place. So I just can you talk a little bit about why, how those two things are different and how you're not double counting there?
Sure, David. They are, there's procurement savings under the overgeneration, but we specifically set up the analysis that we would take the reduction in overgeneration and procurement implications of that from the export capability first. And so we capture that first in that number three bucket, more efficient overgeneration management. Then incremental to that, starting from that position, that's when we then add in the wind and substitute resources there. And there's
a subsequent additional lowering of our generation that happens as a result of that more diverse portfolio, but it's over and above or incremental to what's already been captured in the
Okay, I understand. Thank you very much.
Our next question is from Mike. Please make sure to state your name and company, and please go ahead.
Yes, can you hear me?
Yes, hi.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, this is Mike Florio from CPUC. I had a question about the transmission that's assumed to deliver the Wyoming wind. In the technical appendix, you indicate it's gateway segments D and F. And I'm not that conversant about PacifiCorp's transmission system, but from what I could gather, that gets you as far west as Hemingway, but how does that wind, you have 2,500 megawatts of Wyoming wind coming to California, does it take additional transmission to get from Hemingway to California, or is there something else here that I'm missing?
Hey, Mike, this is Rick at PacifiCorp. You're correct. It does make reference in the technical appendix to two transmission segments that PacifiCorp has been evaluating for several years and planning for. They're labeled as segments D and F, which in aggregate take transmission capability outside or from eastern Wyoming down two different lines across PacifiCorp system over towards the west. That's segment D, and then down south through Utah, which is segment F. Those two transmission projects would allow wind to be built in eastern Wyoming and get out of that part of the state, which would require incremental transmission infrastructure to be added to the system for that to occur. And then from there, I go back to Phil's opening comments earlier about how this entire integration effort leads to one new broader and larger consolidated BAA, as opposed to having to have transmission go all the way from Wyoming into California. In effect, it's within the new footprint of this BAA, and that wind can be sunk to load within anywhere within that BAA, subject to that transmission addition, as well as existing transmission or any other incremental transmission built as a result of coordinated transmission planning process over time.
I get that it's deliverable to load anywhere in the new footprint, but if we've only got 776 megawatts of transfer capacity, I'm still not getting how we could get 2,500 megawatts of Wyoming wind with only 776 megawatts of transfer capacity.
Yeah, and the 776 is directional from what is today the ISO footprint to PacifiCorp's footprint. The other direction, I believe the number was a little higher in the 900 or so range. But also kind of going back to, the slide that I walked through earlier to introduce our system, recognizing that PacifiCorp has a sizable load as well within the region to absorb some of that power as well. So there's load and there's a combination of transmission that could be used to basically consume that output to load.
And Mike, this is Phil. I just want to come back and try to help clarify this point. We did not in the study, we did not identify sufficient transmission to get 2,500 megawatts all the way to California load. This goes back to our discussion about, what's the definition under current law about bucket one. And so that sort of underscores what Rick was saying is, while there may be some portion of transfer capability that could be benefited, it is a larger balancing authority, and as a result, that can still be delivered to that new
larger balancing authority.
So if I understand what you're saying, it could be that the physical flow is to PacifiCorp load, but it could count for California RPS because it's deliverable to the expanded footprint of combined system load.
That's correct.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
Our next question is from Kevin. Please go ahead.
Hi, Kevin Woodruff, consultant for Turn. I have kind of a geeky question. I'm looking at slide 16, which shows a PacifiCorp load curve. Looks like your combined load peaks about like 2 p.m., hour 14, maybe 3 p.m. And on slide 18, of course, you have a peak that's more like, you know, 7 p.m. And I understand there might be some averaging and different seasons here, but what is a typical peak load for PacifiCorp's loads? Is this like chart, this line on slide 16 drawn correctly, or what's going on?
I think slide 16 is more of an illustrative figure to really get the concept of coincidence versus non-coincidence communicated.
Okay.
PacifiCorp system, depending upon which part of the system you're looking at, but in aggregate would typically peak more in the evening hours. More aligned, I think, with the slide that you had referenced on slide 18.
18, okay. And is that a winter peak or is it that way all year?
You know, it's really going to change whether it, by season, by part of our system, whether it's east or west.
Okay.
And so the load profiles are depending upon where you are.
Rick, can we expand on that? Because one of the things my understanding is the PAC East is a summer peaking system, but PAC West is a winter peaking system, right?
That's true. That is true in terms of the seasonality, but within the hours of the day, I'd say most often we are typically on an aggregate peaking more in the evening hours. There are certain pockets of our system where it's perhaps a little more flat and changes, or it's even morning and evening, depending on the type of customers we have in that particular part of the system.
Okay. Thanks. And then on slide 18, I see we're still there. Is that still an illustrative loads here?
Yes, that is. That's a projected day on 2030.
Okay, so you're not. It's basically, if you look at the two ISO charts, it shows they don't. There's no. Are you presuming that there'd be no change in within the state? I'm sorry. Let me start this question over.
Sure.
Are you presuming that post-integration and the export of excess solar is, which facilitates, doesn't make it necessarily make it possible, but it facilitates the export of solar power, excess solar into the PacifiCorp territory. Are you presuming that there's no sort of change in the underlying dispatch in California? I think for purposes of this chart, that's what it looks like.
Yeah. I think for purposes of this chart, the overgeneration is the only real thing that's changing. The thermal units in California are already running in those hours at essentially their minimum level
right.
That we held on. So there's not an increase in thermal
okay.
dispatch there.
Okay, good. You got my inarticulate question. Thank you.
Yes, sure.
All right, operator, I think we have two additional questions in the queue.
Yes, our next question is from Mark. Please go ahead.
Hi, thank you. This is Mark Milburn with LS Power. As a follow-up to the previous question about transmission and the transfer limit, and understanding that you considered in the Wyoming wind build-out for the high case some transmission, and specifically the two gateway segments, did you attempt to model or quantify in any way if that build-out would also raise the 776 limit and then what the associated residual benefits of that might be for some of the other cost benefits in the study?
No, Mark, we didn't. We kept that separate.
Okay. And then with respect to the transmission costs, did you use essentially the two gateway segments and then add some additional transmission costs, or did you use a more generic sort of assumption to integrate the transmission costs into the Wyoming build-out case?
Yeah, so we employed, Mark, the transmission costs for those two segments that PacifiCorp applied and analyzing those in its 2015 IRP. And I believe those numbers are identified in the technical appendix on a levelized basis.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Great. Thank you. So, operator, you said that the person that had their hand in the queue lowered it.
Yes. Our last question is from Joseph. His audio, I'm not able to open it at this time, so I can read his question out loud.
Okay. Go ahead.
He wants to know what transmission plans are CAISO and PacifiCorp making to improve the transmission transfer capability between their regions, and if so, what impact will this have on the TAC in each region and on the integration benefits?
I guess I'll take this one.
This is Phil Pettengill. Where we go with transmission changes to the system is really going to happen in the ISO's transmission planning process. And so the long and short of it is that'll be an integrated transmission plan with ISO and PacifiCorp working together. If PacifiCorp moves forward and decides to join this restructured ISO. So at that point, then we would look at what are the appropriate changes or improvements that would drive the appropriate benefits in that integrated system. I think folks can understand that in this study, as we've answered some of the questions, we didn't attempt to do that now, but that is something that would happen in the transmission planning process potentially going forward. In regards to the transmission access charge, that's why it's important to understand that is a stakeholder initiative that the ISO will be opening up here, and that really goes to the notion of, well, how would any transmission costs that are coming out of that integrated transmission plan, how are those costs going to be allocated across the larger region? And because we haven't even started that initiative, you know, we'll look forward to that discussion with stakeholders as we walk through that process. So folks, let's move to this last segment and just sort of wrap up, and then we'll see if there's any last questions. Rick, you want to talk about the implementation costs maybe, and then I'll talk about sort of the ongoing piece?
Sure. Just real briefly, you know, the report focuses on benefits. As we indicated earlier, it's a focus on the sufficient benefits to continue exploring, you know, this further concept of a regional ISO. You know, and however, we wanted to include in the report that there are some elements just at least to define the types of costs that will need to be considered going forward. For PacifiCorp, we didn't quantify those, but at least wanted to provide some backdrop and definitional context to what those might be. So there will be, should there be an ongoing effort to complete an integration process, you know, PacifiCorp would encounter some one-time costs to go through implementation. This might include things like metering and some IT infrastructure, things of that nature in order to be able to complete integration into this regional ISO. And that, of course, noting that we would fully leverage any applications we already have that have been implemented in the EIM and working through that effort. At this stage, we're now you know, trying to identify what those cost items might be, what the magnitudes are, what the timing might look like, but we haven't yet quantified them and didn't produce them in the report. There are additional ongoing costs, and I'll let Phil touch on those two categories.
Thanks, Rick. I just wanted to say that I think we've touched on the transmission access charge with some of the questions we received. We're committed to work through a stakeholder initiative to talk about what or how those costs might change. But more importantly, it's certainly something that PacifiCorp will need to consider in terms of their business case. And the reason we mentioned the grid management charge is that's certainly one other cost item that PacifiCorp, for a matter, any other interested party would have in joining the ISO. So to the extent that it makes sense to consider how that would change or potentially be modified to help support integration of PacifiCorp or any other PCOs,
then that, again, may be another topic that we would take up in a stakeholder initiative. So our commitment, again, is to come back to those issues as appropriate and have a discussion about how those costs are addressed under the ISO tariff. Jack, let's go to the last slide, the conclusions, if you will, and just say, so what did we conclude in the report? And then let's wrap this up for one last round of questions.
Yes. So overall, the report concludes that integration provides quantified benefits that are both large and, it's important to recognize, are growing over time. Both ISO and PacifiCorp have seen that range of benefits being enough to continue progress towards integration. And longer term, I think it's really important to recognize that that integration provides more flexibility to respond to the changing needs within the state, either to meet environmental policies, develop renewable energy, and lower greenhouse gas emissions at a lower cost than would be done separately. A lot of these benefits are, the high-value benefits are longer term, but they're linked to planning investment decisions that take long lead times to get done. And so that's why it's important for decisions to be made sooner and for progress to be made sooner for capturing those.
Thank you, Jack. And so just to wrap here, we wanted to make sure folks were aware of, and our last slide indicates where you can go to get additional information. We've got our media release, the frequently asked questions, and more importantly, as we've said a couple times on this call, we do want to hear from you. And so we've got the ISO's email address here in order to be able to submit additional questions or requests in terms of understanding the report. We would like to have those as quick as we can just so we can make sure we understand where we're at, and that will help support moving forward with our stakeholder process and also provide some input into how the ISO will proceed in the studies we need to do under SB 350. So with that, Christina, where are we?
We do have some people that just dialed in, so they can't see the slides. So if you do have questions, we'll be taking questions in the ISORC at caiso.com mailbox. And as I mentioned at the beginning of the call, we did record this call, and we are going to make it available on our website. It takes a couple of days for us to get the file from AT&T. So once we have the file uploaded to our website, we'll send out a market notice letting folks know that it's available. And we'll also include in that market notice a link to the presentation today, as well as the study and any other materials you might find. So, operator, do we have any questions in the queue before we conclude?
Yes, we do have two last questions in the queue.
Okay. Just a reminder to please state your name and the company you represent.
Please go ahead.
This is Doug Bushin from Flynn Resource Consultants. My question is about...
You're a little muffled. Can you repeat that? Sorry. You're a little muffled. Can you repeat your name?
Yes, it's Doug Bocignone. I'm with Flynn Resource Consultants.
Great, thank you. We can hear you now.
My question is about the overgeneration analysis. Did the report assume that absent integration, there would be no exports from California to PacifiCorp? And also, I'm curious about the assumptions that were made about exports at all the interties with and without PacifiCorp integration.
Mm-hmm. So the overgeneration is calculated from the RPS calculator. It does set a minimum of zero exports and zero imports as the minimum level there.
Net export.
Yes.
Which means that that's already some of the dedicated contractual imports are already turned around and going out. So it's a net export of zero. Anything else, Doug?
No, thank you.
Our next question is from Kevin. Please go ahead.
Hi, Kevin Woodruff, consultant for Turin. One last time, I would anticipate that the questions and the that you were soliciting in a couple of weeks, you're going to post them like you do your sort of your typical stakeholder, post the questions and answers.
We can do that.
Okay. Thanks. That's it.
Okay. All right, operator, do we have any other questions?
Yes, we have one last question.
Okay.
Your line is
go ahead. Hello?
Hello? Hello?
Yes, hi.
Hi, this is Rishi Bakker from Tenasca. And my question is, in the study, what assumptions have you made regarding energy storage additions to the CalISO? It would appear that some of the benefits of the integration are similar to benefits that energy storage provides. And to the extent, you know, it's a long horizon, 20 years, you could see energy storage picking up or installation picking up. That could potentially reduce the benefits that are mentioned in the study. So what assumptions have you made there?
Yeah, so storage, some of that storage is in the case, in the base case of the RPS calculator. Overall, though, I think the cost of building new storage in this is more expensive than integration.
So you're saying you're not building into any incremental energy storage beyond what's sort of mandated by regulation in CalISO today?
Yeah, there's not new storage in that. You could have some storage and integration as well, a combined solution, which gives you even more of a weighted over integration.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, well, let me just say thank you, everybody, for joining us today. We appreciate the opportunity to explain the report and look forward to any other questions you may have, and we'll terminate the call here. Thank you.